This is going to be a Blackboard lecture. The next will be a Blackboard lecture. The last one will probably be a laptop lecture. And the idea is to take the ideas here from the very beginning, where it's very easy to understand. So if you know some quantum information, if you know a certain amount of background, it's pretty close. You can get to the ideas of DMRG pretty quickly, but I think there's a big advantage to take the slow route, which is more in line with the historical development of DMRG, because you get a lot of intuition along the way, and of course not everybody has the same background. So this starts with a background, but doesn't assume very much. Okay, so we'll start lecture one. This is going to be starting with the numerical renormalization group and going on to one particle analysis of it. And then we'll have a version of DMRG or one particle. Now, DMRG is really a many-particle procedure. The many-particle aspects of it can get it can get quite complicated, because part of DMRG is doing Langshaus-type diagonalizations, just like we heard earlier today. That can get a little bit complicated. Dealing with many particles in general is complicated. What's interesting is that you can understand a big chunk of how the DMRG algorithm works just by looking at a one-particle system. It's really just the physics of a particle in a box in one dimension. It's very easy. And so you can do most of your work there, get going before you start going into the many-particle aspects. So that's what we'll do for this lecture. The key part, maybe the most important part of this, is what you do as homework. And so this, I'm going to show you sort of the simplest sort of DMRG for one particle program. And then the homework is to basically play with that. I'll give you a set of projects or questions that you can attack, the first of which is just somehow to get a program like what I show you going on your own machine. But then playing with this is the way you really sort of understand one of these techniques in enough detail to do any good. Lecture two, that's when we'll turn on the many particle aspects. And lecture three, we'll talk about sort of more state-of-the-art details. So through most of this, we'll just be talking about one dimension. But when we get to lecture three, we'll talk about what you can do towards two dimensions. It's often said that DMRG is a one-dimensional method, but if you think of a two-dimensional strip as basically being a one-dimensional system, then it's just a question of how wide a system you can do. And it turns out that we can do reasonably wide systems, say with 8 or 10 or 12, for interesting problems. And so I'll show you some of the results of what we can do for that. And that'll be on Friday. Okay, so I'm gonna start now with a sort of simplified method that was sort of loosely based on a treatment that Wilson did for the condo impurity problem. So this is Wilson's. Miracle of RG. So Wilson had a wonderful analysis of the condo impurity problem. It's written up in a Rev Mod Phys, that's the original piece of work. And he gives all the details. And part of this was analyzing the physics of the impurity problem and setting up the Hamiltonian. And then, and part of it was a detailed analysis of the renormalization loop aspects, but sort of buried in the middle there was an algorithm. What I'm going to do is just take that algorithm and apply it in a different context than the impurity problem, but to say that we want to simulate a 1D lattice system with this same sort of renormalization loop procedure. Okay. So you have in the notes the reference to Wilson's work. So basically, we have a 1D lattice system. And then we're going to take parts of that and just put a box around those and call them blocks. Call the block B. When we look at this block, we're going to treat the parts of the Hamiltonian into two different, we'll divide it into two different parts. Of course, there's the parts inside the block, hoppings between the sites. There's the parts outside, and then there are the parts that are connecting the block to the rest of the system. And as we go along with this method, these will just be cut or ignored. Okay, so the procedure that I'm going to describe starts out with okay, first we take this block, and the initial block is small enough so that we can do an exact diagonalization of it, not with line shows, but with a full diagonalization so we can get a large number of eigenstates. So we're going to diagonalize. And when I say diagonalize block B, I mean we're diagonalizing the Hamiltonian. And it's the Hamiltonian with just the rest of the system ignored. And sort of thinking about what the rest of the system does later on is an essential part of improving on this. Okay. Second, we're going to take these eigenvalues and here's the ground state for this block, and here's going up in energy. And we're going to decide that we're going to keep a certain number of states, and that will involve sort of drawing a line here and saying for the lower energy states, we're going to keep these states, and for the higher energy states, we're going to throw them away. Okay, and the way you think about this at this stage is just that what we're really interested in is the ground state of some larger non-trivial system. And so you think of doing a small system with a short length scale, think of short length scales as being higher in energy. So you think of these states that you're throwing away as being higher in energy, shorter length scales, we'll throw them away. Sort of thinking in general in terms of renormalization loop ideas. And so we hope that this keeping these lowest energy states is not too bad. Turns out that it will be, and we'll see why that is. Okay, so we decide to keep these, and then the next procedure is just to rewrite the Hamiltonian, rewrite our system in terms of a reduced basis. So reduced basis sets are common approximations in lots of areas of quantum mechanics, numerical quantum mechanics. In quantum chemistry, it's called configuration interaction in at least one form. So some sort of reduced basis is quite common. Often it's throwing away single particle levels. What's different about this is that we're keeping a set of non-trivial interacting states and throwing away another set of non-trivial interacting states. But the procedure for keeping a set of states is pretty simple, at least conceptually. So we're going to take these eigenstates and we're going to call them B, B1 up to B sub n, and then we'll keep B1 up to a smaller number m, Bm. We form a matrix out of these eigenvectors, B1 up to Bm. This is a rectangular matrix, so this dimension may be quite large. This is the dimension of the Hilbert space of our block. This dimension here, m, the number of states we keep, that can be whatever we want, could be as large as n, but often, and here will be quite large, and m will be some small number that depends on how much computer resources we want to throw at the problem. Maybe 10, maybe 100, maybe 1,000. Okay. So then we take this matrix, which can be used to do both a unitary or orthogonal transformation of the Hamiltonian, and also to do the truncation, because it's not a square matrix. And so we get what we'll call a renormalized block, B prime, a renormalized Hamiltonian, H prime, which looks like O transpose. I'm going to be assuming for whenever I can that the objects I'm working with are real, and so I'm often writing transposes instead of collision conjugates. And so I can transform the Hamiltonian for the block in this fashion. And so this is an M by N matrix, an N by N matrix, and an N by M. So I've reduced the size of that matrix. And the idea is that if the states that we're keeping here are relevant states, then in some sense, the new transformed Hamiltonian is close to the old Hamiltonian, at least for the low energy sector. Now, when you do this, you also have to worry about combining two different blocks together and the connections between them. Okay, so the next step of the algorithm is to combine two blocks together. So the idea is here's a block, here's another block, and then they're going to go to a new larger block. And this has m states describing it. This has n states. This, if you take a interacting system and you put it together, the two equal parts, it would have m squared states, but we're going to truncate that down to m. Okay, so this step here, combining the two blocks, we'll combine the two B prime blocks. So the states, I can write it in this sort of symbolic fashion, like this. Okay, so when I write this, I'm just sort of doing a shorthand notation for what you do with the states. So basically, you can think of a state of the combined block as being a state that's written in this Brock-Kett fashion with a state of the left block and a state of the right block, or write it out like this. So the states are very simple to put together. So at this stage, we're just keeping it with the old n squared states. And then the Hamiltonian we have to put together in the right way. So there's a Hamiltonian for the new double block. And that has pieces that came from the Hamiltonian of the left-hand side. That looks like this. So we're taking here a Hamiltonian term that's, say, an S dot S interaction for the left-hand side. And when you're merging Hilbert spaces like that, what you're really doing is you're saying that the operator on the right-hand side is just a unit operator. And so this is for the left-hand side. And then we have a similar thing for the right-hand side. And then we have the terms that connect between them. Okay, so how do these terms that connect between them work? So these blocks are made of sites. And here's the right side of the left block and the left side of the right block. And there might be a term connecting them. And let's say this term is an SZI, SZI plus 1. So this would be part of the Heisenberg interaction I'm thinking about. And then you do other terms, just add it together. And so the way this interaction works in terms of the tensor notation, SZI, SZI plus 1 double prime is equal to this tensor product, SZI prime cross SZI plus 1. And the way I like to think of the tensor products, just to have it the simplest way to think about these tensor products is just to think of them as sticking indices on together. So this SZ, SZI plus 1, so the if you do it in terms of indices, it has indices J1, J2, J1 prime, J2 prime, and that's written as SZI J1, J1 prime, SZI plus 1 prime, J2, J2 prime. Okay, so an operator on a block, or any operator, is something with two indices. So J1 and J1 prime are like the states up and down for if you're talking about a single site. When we're talking about blocks, then J1 and J1 prime can be more general states, and there's a matrix representation for that operator. And then when you combine two blocks like this, and you're doing the tensor product, I like to think of it as just really taking the compound object that has all four indices. And then if you want to write it back in terms of a new index, say a J tilde and a J tilde prime, so that it looks more like a usual operator, it's just a matter of combining these indices with some sort of order chosen for those indices to act as one index. So if this has n, if this goes from 1 to m, that goes from 1 to m. J tilde goes from 1 to m squared, and you choose a column order or row order, and you just assign these indices. Okay. Okay, so once we've done this, we've constructed a new Hamiltonian for the block. We put the two pieces together, and then the last step of this is to make it an iterative algorithm. We replace B by B double prime and repeat. So what you get is a method that you can keep going forever, and the calculation doesn't blow up. So if you just take a system, the quantum system, and you're trying to diagonalize it for larger and larger systems, the number of states involved goes up exponentially. This is a method, it may not give the right answer, but this is the method that continually reduces the number of states in a block down to a fixed number so that you can continue on. And so it's very appealing that way, scales up to whatever size you want. Okay. So the justification for this procedure, I've already talked a little bit about. The idea is that we're throwing out the high energy states, and we're interested in the ground state. We're throwing out states that live on short length scales, and we think of low energy states living on long length scales. But in the first context that this was used, Wilson used it on an impurity problem. And in the impurity problem, the structure was a little bit different from this lattice with the doubling of the block at each stage. Instead, it looked like a lattice where you add one site at a time. So it's like your right block is always just one site. And you add a site one at a time. But the procedure, the numerical procedure otherwise, is basically just like I described here. Okay, now, when Wilson applied it to the Kondo-Apuri problem, the Hamiltonian that he was working with, because it was an Apuri problem that didn't describe, it described shells in K-space going out from an Apuri, the energy structure of those of that lattice was quite different from what we ordinarily do within a 1D lattice. The energy scales were getting smaller and smaller as you went out. If you have an energy scale structure for your starting problem that has the energy scales decreasing as you go out in the right way, and you add them one site at a time, then you can justify this procedure in terms of basically a perturbation theory analysis and find that it works. And so when Wilson originally applied this, he did a very careful analysis and showed why it worked and tested it in detail to see that it worked. Okay. And so that was the original application.
So, yeah, question?
Yeah.
Just a couple of questions. One, how do you grow the block? Both ends?
So in this procedure, we're just starting with a block and looking at it, and it's part of an infinite lattice. And then we just keep doubling the block. Okay. And well, you think of dividing the block into, say, groups of 10 sites. And you treat each one, but each one is identical. So they all get treated that way. And then you group them in pairs, but you're still thinking of it always as part of an infinite lattice.
How does the m squared get reduced to m? Okay.
That's this step here. And I wrote it a little bit out of order, but the first step here says that you diagonalize the block for however many states you have, and you decide to throw away the states in energy, ordered by energy, starting with m plus 1. So you sort of automatically have decided, okay, I only have m states.
Well, that's reducing from n to m.
That's reducing from n to m. So over here, this m squared is our new m.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And the connecting terms are these matrices are here.
Right. So your connecting terms are always, for a system with nearest neighbor interactions, you just take the interaction terms for the last site and the first site, and you connect them. Now what that means is that you don't just keep track of the block Hamiltonian. When you start off, you know exactly what the matrix form for each of your operators in the system, each S of Z, S of X, whatever. The ones on the border, you have to keep track of in order to build up the connecting terms. But you don't have to keep track of the ones in the center of the system. Those sort of get renormalized so that they don't matter. But you have to keep track of the ones on the edge and keep transforming them as you go along. Okay, so just to summarize, so this work for the condo impurity. Okay, and then historically what happened was people thought, okay, Wilson had this wonderful technique, he solved the condo impurity problem, let's apply it to regular lattice problems. And so they came up with this approach. And they tried it and it was a failure. So when you try this, as I've described it, I've described a method here that it just sort of fails. Wilson understood that it wasn't going to work from the start, and he sort of analyzed what went wrong. And so that's the next part of our story, is Wilson's analysis of what went wrong. So this failed. More lattice models. Okay. Right now we're not assuming anything about the, this would, in the lattice form, it would fail even if there was a gap. Okay. So now let me go to Wilson's analysis. This is where I have to use. So Wilson said, his attitude was, well, it's very hard to understand exactly how these algorithms work when you're doing, non-trivial things to them, and they're complicated interacting systems. And so Wilson said, well, let's just take the very simplest system that the ideas can still be applied to and see if it works there, and if it doesn't work, we can understand why. And so that system, where you can still apply it to, is a particle in a box. And we don't use the usual continuum particle in a box, we put it on the lattice. Okay, so the Hamiltonian we'll be looking at, ignoring factors of H bar and mass and things, is minus d squared dx squared with a boundary condition psi of 0 equals psi of L equals 0, but then we put it on a lattice. And we use the simplest version of putting things on a lattice, which is called finite differences. Okay, and I'm going to ignore a factor of 1 over the lattice spacing squared in front, and just go directly to a simple matrix form, 2 minus 1, minus 1, 2, minus 1, minus 1, 2. Everything else is zero, going out to the edge of the system. Okay, so this will, in the limit that the lattice spacing goes to zero, this will, this form will recover minus d squared dx squared, and you'll get particle in a box solutions. Okay, so now let's, first of all, describe the details of how you implement this in a way that, and it's a simple enough thing that, you know, you can write an easy program for, and it'll be related to what I want you to do for homework. Okay, so the key difference for this, since this is a one particle problem, the key difference is that when you combine two different blocks with, say, m states and m states, instead of getting m squared different states, you get 2m. So you just think of a vector with the left block in the top half of the vector and the right block in the lower half of the vector. Okay? And so that makes it not flow exponentially. It makes everything easier. Okay, so we're good. First step is to write it in terms of Hamiltonians and interaction terms. So the interaction terms will be like these pieces that connect together. We'll just call it a T. So we're going to start with an H block, which I'll just write as H. And this is going to be a 1x1 matrix with the number 2 in it. And that is going to be considering a block that looks like that. So you know, the blocks go along the left side and the right hand side. You'll get one block, and the Hamiltonian that connects that block to itself is just 2. This is just a one side block. Okay, and then we have the connecting term T is -1 written as a matrix. Okay, and here's that -1. So this is the first block, that's the second block. This is the term that connects those two blocks. And so it's just this -1. Okay, now the first step in this way of doing it, I'll say we're going to, you know, we can't start with the diagonalization here because it's already diagonal. So the first step is to combine two blocks. Okay, so that says that our H prime is an H, T, T transpose, and an H. Okay, and in the first step, this is just a 2x2 matrix. It's just 2 -1 -1 2. That's the block, that's the Hamiltonian of our block that's twice the size. And then, if we're going to write it in this block form, then the so this guy is now our H for the larger block, and this guy is the connecting term for the larger block. So this looks like 0, 0, T, 0. So now we will diagonalize, this is step 2, diagonalize H prime, get our eigenvectors.
Does it matter if you choose the one to the right or the left, or keep right?
I'm really thinking of this lattice sort of going off to infinity, and so I'm just looking. You could just say I'm looking at some guy in the middle, and then the guy next to it, like that. And the difference between these is a -1 in the lower left versus the upper right, which is just the transpose. Okay, so when you diagonalize this, we keep however many states we want, say m. So again, we form r equals b1 to bm. Okay, and we change basis and truncate. So H double prime is equal to O transpose, because we call this H prime, O, and T double prime is equal to O transpose T prime O. Now, when you, the way you want to think about getting these is not quite as obvious as I've written down. What you want to think about it is a set of O's like this, but sort of repeated in block form. So here's an O, here's an O, here's an O. And then you're applying this sort of very large matrix on both sides. And then when you work out how the pieces come together, it just looks like that. Okay. And then we replace H by H double prime and the T. Okay, so Wilson carried it out to here, and then he showed how badly it worked. And you are not just looking at for the ground state; you're really trying to get the low-lying spectrum right. That's particularly true in this one-particle system, because sometimes the ground state is just trivial. And so what we do is we just see how good the energies come out after you repeat this a number of times. And so here's a result with 10 blockings. Okay, now Wilson's work in sort of showing what was wrong was another example that Matthias, like what Matthias told us about this morning, where it was wrong and so it didn't get published. And Wilson was one of my thesis advisors. He gave a group meeting talk and explained how this worked. And, you know, so that was the method of propagation. It turned out to be enough. But you can't look up Wilson's analysis. But so the calculations I'll show you is when we eventually figured out how to solve it, we repeated things. And these are this is from that. Okay, so 10 blockings equals m equals 8 states. Okay, and the exact, you can calculate yourself. And what you see right away, I'll just write down a few numbers. Is and then the RG is that the RG has no relationship to the exact results. Okay, and I assume you all have the notes, but you can see these are completely different, complete off by four orders of magnitude. It's not just a constant shift. If you look at in more detail, you find that there's just no relationship to the exact result. Essentially, what you've got coming out of this method is garbage.
Does it converse at least, and does it decrease as you increase the number of blocks?
It's just garbage, and you'll see why in a second. And once you see why, you'll probably be able to figure it out with your intuition. You know, what it might do. Okay. So the nice thing about the particle in the box is that we have great intuition for one particle. And so let me draw the pictures for what we've just been doing. Okay, so what is the ground state for a particle in a box? Here it is. Whatever box size you have, that's what the ground state is. Okay, so it's easiest to think just about doing the ground state at first. So what did we do? We started with a diagonalization of a small block. Okay, and then eventually with the next step, the states that we kept are supposed to be the building blocks for a block twice as big. So So if we have just one state that we're keeping, we've got, this is the base, this is a basis, this is a building block for our system. We've got another one that's the same, and we're trying to build a state just to get the next iteration right. We're trying to build that state twice as big. Okay, and so now you just picture, okay, I've got a function that looks like this. If you translate this function to be twice as big, you know, it looks like zero on the other side, this guy looks zero on the other side. You can add them together. If you add them together, you get that. But you can't get this nice smooth function. Okay, but we're not just keeping one state. So you say, okay, but I was keeping eight states here. And those eight states can help build a better wave function on a larger scale. Okay, but if we think of the boundary conditions that we're applying here is to set the wave function to zero on the edge of the block. And so even if we keep a number of excited states, they still are subject to that same boundary condition. And so they all go to zero in the center. And so you always end up with some sort of node or kink here in the center at the dividing line. And the only way that you can get around that is if you keep all the states in the block. If you keep all the states in the block, then this continuum picture of it is no longer valid. You're keeping all states. You just have to think of it as a lattice problem. You keep all states, and you're keeping a complete set. And then you can represent this thing nicely as a complete set. Okay, as if you keep all the states. But as soon as you have a big enough problem compared to your starting system where you're just keeping a small number of states, then this picture in terms of boundary conditions applies, and you always have kinks at the edges. Okay, so that's the basic idea for what's wrong with the system.
Why is it necessary to have those boundary conditions?
Okay, good. So that's the next step. So, in the group meeting, the first question, why didn't you use periodic boundary conditions? And then there's other boundary conditions also. So let me talk about that.
This problem is a function of the seismic block, and it's too convergent.
Well, if you're looking at the energy, you know, the block goes to infinity, the energy goes as 1 over y squared. Yeah. And these kinks give you, as soon as you truncate, they set a length scale where you've got an error in the energy that you never fix. And so they have this big, you know, error in the energy from early on that never goes away. And then if you think about it in terms of the actual wave function, it's got kinks, and there's nothing in the later stages that gets rid of any kinks. And so it's just bad on all. Yeah.
Why it works for the condo model?
The condo model, you think of it as, you can think of it as like a model with hopping, where the first hopping is of order 1, the next hopping is of order 0.1, 0.01, 0.01. So when you do a block, and of course it's not as extreme as that. But you do a block, and these little things here are very tiny. They're, but it's valid to think of them as a perturbation. And so you're over here, the states that you're throwing away are the states associated with the first sites with their big energy scales. And so you throw them away. They've got some of the correct perturbations from the next few sites in. The farther away ones don't matter. So that's the sort of justification that's valid and makes the, you know, the numerical RG still a good approach for quantum security problems. Okay, so the question is, what about boundary conditions? Now, the first thing to say is that the boundary, when people apply this to real problems, you know, they just jump to their hardest real problem without understanding in an intuitive way what was going on, and so they just did it this way. But now that we understand it a little bit, we start to think about boundary conditions. And so the first thing you might say, there's a PRL associated with this, with how to fix it. When it's I'm always still sort of surprised that we got that in the physical review letter when we solved the particle in a box. This is not very usual, and but it's an interesting story about that. What I'm going to show you is how we fixed this particular problem, which, you know, pretty much nobody knew that there was a problem, or they didn't really understand, you know, that anybody was looking at this problem from a one particle perspective. But we sent it off to Visoret Letters, you know, saying, okay, we might get lucky. We didn't get lucky, and it got, you know, a pretty good referees report that showed that the person, you know, understood what we were doing and thought, hey, this is not bad, but it's obviously not PRL, but it's, you know, not bad. And so we got this rejection letter. And then, and you can have it in Visoret B or someplace, you know. And we're writing up saying, okay, we're going to, you know, that's fine. We'll have it in Visoret B. I don't remember if it was Rapid Communications. We got this new letter from the journal saying, oh, we got another referees report, and so now we're going to accept. Well, you know, usually if you get one good and one bad, you have to fight a long time. And in this case, somehow we got a second referees report that turned over the first one, and they just accepted it. And we were just sort of blown away. But then I thought, okay, that must have been Wilson. You know, who else, you know, okay. And it was a very perceptive, reference report. And so I thought, okay, it had to be Wilson. He understood, you know, that what we did could really lead to something, and they took his word for it. Okay, so how do you fix it? First thing is you try periodic boundary conditions. And, you know, here's a wave function that you might have with periodic boundary conditions. Here's an excited state with periodic boundary conditions. And the key thing is that, you know, it matches at the two sides. And so if you do periodic boundary conditions, your wave function is the same as the two sides. And so if you try to put them together to make some wave function at a larger scale like this, out of little pieces like this, you always get staircases. Because this is the left end of a little block, and this is the right end of a little block, and they have to be the same. It doesn't help, you can make it wiggle in the middle, but they have to be the same there, so the best you can do is basically staircases, and that's still sort of too lousy to be worth anything. Okay, so that's the problem with periodic boundary conditions. Now, a nicer one is you can adjust the boundary condition so it doesn't go to zero at the edges. You can't just make a boundary condition that's totally free. You can't make a boundary condition that just lets the wave function sort of do whatever it wants. There always has to be some sort of termination. So the closest you can come is if you take the matrix with its twos and minus ones, but you take the last two and you make it a one, then this is what we call free boundary conditions. And this gives psi prime of 0 is equal to 0. So it gives you 0 slope, but it doesn't constrain the value of the wave function. Okay, now this one does a little bit better than, say, staircases. but it still has the problem of flat spots. So you're trying to make a wave function on a larger scale out of little pieces, but at the boundary, it's always flat. So you can kind of do that and sort of get rounded stairs, but it's always got to be flat at the boundary. So that's another problem with the system. Okay, so so these simple ideas for boundary conditions don't work, but it's not too big a change to get something that does work. So the change that works is to combine more than one set of boundary conditions. And this is one type of solution. So I just wrote down I've got colored chalk. It would be nice if there were, I might, may run out of white chalk. There's a chalk there. Okay, so we can combine different boundary conditions. And so, for instance, the original boundary conditions had a 2 on the edge. We call those fixed. And these here, with the 1 on the edge, we call free. And so you can do a fixed free combination. Okay, so what does that mean? If you look at a block, it's got 2 edges, and what we need to do is put both possibilities at each edge. And so we have 4 combinations. So, at the left edge, we have fixed and free. And at the right edge, we have the same also. And so that gives you ground states that look like this. So the free-free just has a constant ground state. And if you're just looking, if you're trying this RG step to see if it works, and you just look at the ground state, well, this looks like it works perfectly, but it doesn't work for the excited states just by itself. So this is the free-free. Okay, and then fixed is going to set the wave function to 0. And so here is a fixed free. Okay, and then the other ones are the other way around. And the original fixed fixed. Okay, that's the ground state for each one. And to do this, we don't just keep the ground state. We want to keep n states, and so we assume m is a multiple of 4, and we just divide them up. Okay, so you just take your O matrix, and you divide it into 4 pieces, and over here we'll put the fixed fixed. And we put our b's here, b1, b2, okay, and then over here we have b1, b2 for the next boundary condition. But this is a different wave function. This is a different boundary condition. So we call this a b prime, b double prime 1, b double prime 2, etc. for the 4 different types of boundary conditions. If you make this matrix, you immediately realize that wave functions from different Hamiltonians are not orthogonal. And when you change the boundary conditions, it's the same as changing the Hamiltonian. And so the different low-lying states that we have here are not orthogonal. OK, but they still span a space. And so we can choose any orthogonalization procedure that we want and still get something that spans that space. So we just do a Gram-Schmidt. I'm not sure how to spell Gram-Schmidt. Two M's or one M. But okay, so you can form a truncation matrix O here, this transformation and truncation, with say M states here and M here, and this has got M over 4. And you can try this same procedure. And so I was just playing around and trying things with this. I got this idea, and I tried it. And I didn't know, I thought, I understood the boundary conditions a little bit, so I thought, well, this looks like it could be kind of okay. And I tried it. And the key thing here was just being able to try things and see what you got, and then understanding what happens. And it was quite amazing. The answers come out to answers with M equals 8 are about accurate to about 10 places, 10 digits. Okay, so that was sort of stunning because you know you go from methods, and I had tried a number of other variations before this. Wilson had originally suggested some perturbation theory, and I tried variations of that. Everything failed. Perturbation theory worked worse than the original, if that's possible. And all of a sudden this thing, it looked exact. And because when you get something accurate to 10 digits, you usually think, okay, well, it's floating point error that gave the actual error. And so you have to go to quadruple precision. And then you find out, okay, it's really just 10 digits of accuracy. So something is really, there's a key idea that somehow clicked into place here.
If you took a measure of completeness of the set of states that you have, what is the difference between the set that you were using before and this one? In terms of percentage, let's say, and how do they sum up to one?
Well, if you look at the boundaries of each block, then all of a sudden, the previous boundaries, one way to look at it is that there's a logarithmic derivative that is set by the boundary conditions, which is fixed. When you do two boundary conditions on each edge, all of a sudden you allow the wave function to vary and its derivative to vary at the edge. And so all of a sudden it has a great deal more freedom than it used to have. Okay, so that's one way.
I'm saying something quantitative. I mean, if you this property that the hyperspace satisfies the equation 1 equals sum over gram over step. Okay.
Right.
So, and by throwing a number of states, you violate this condition.
Right.
Okay, before probably you were violating it wildly.
Right.
Okay, the question is, how much did you fix that by changing the boundary condition? Is it really going from 1% to 99?
No, it's going from complete error by a factor of 10 to the 5 to an error in 10 trillion. One part of 10 trillion. So that's what's sort of remarkable.
Is there a reason you had to divide up them equally and over 4 for each type?
If you, it's just a question of efficiency. You might think that this one was the least important.
Yes.
No. So if you're going to keep 10 states, you would probably, you know, you wouldn't divide by 4, you'd keep more of this one.
See.
Yeah. So this was just giving a sort of a clue to what was going on. And one clue that it gives is that, you know, you might think that this sort of renormalization group for interacting problems has just been tried and it's failed, and forget about it. Only do quantum Monte Carlo or something. This would say that that's not the right conclusion, that maybe we're missing something. Okay, then the next step is how do you understand how to translate insights here from a one particle problem to a many particle system. Okay, so those are the things that we're going to get to. Okay, now the other clue is that once you have this, then you understand it a little bit better, then there's some more ways to fix it. Okay, so the other way to fix this problem from the notes to go a little bit more quickly. But so let me talk about, in the notes it's called method two. Okay, so the other way, so another way to fix it. Okay, in this method, you say the block knows where it goes. Okay, so you have to get the boundaries somehow very flexible, or if you aren't able to make the boundaries flexible enough, say an interacting system, then you can make the boundaries more specific so that they know where they go. So suppose we have just one final size. Call it L. And so here, and we're looking for the ground state. From 0 to L. And L is big, and so we're doing it in pieces. So here's a piece that we have. Okay, it's obvious that if you knew the ground state, you could pick out the piece that came from that ground state that looks just like this, and use that as the basis for this block. So this guy you're going to use, here's 0, you go up. And you're going to keep this state. And if this, if you choose this state perfectly, then it will exactly match. And if you choose every other state perfectly, then obviously you can recover the whole big ground state. So we choose the basis adapter for the final state. Okay, now it doesn't have to be just one state, and you don't have to just have the final destination. But a key aspect of this is that you're looking at a bigger system, and you're acknowledging that this block is part of a bigger system. So this is sort of a trivial way of doing it. Another way to do it, which is more general, is you could just use a block that's bigger. So we're trying to pick the right wave function to go in this block. Okay, let's make what we call a super block that's bigger, but not necessarily enormous. Okay, so here's the super block. Okay, and with this procedure, it turns out to be similar to this combination of boundary conditions. With this procedure, what you can do is you can diagonalize the super block. This super block size is not our final size. It's just bigger than the size where we are. We diagonalize the super block and find m states. And then we project each of those states down to the block. So if one of the states looks like that, we take a piece that looks just like this piece. And if another state looks like that, we take a piece that looks like that. Now, the wave functions that we're looking at on the super block scale are all orthogonal because they came from the diagonalization of a system. But when you project out a piece, just sort of cutting out that part of the wave function, all of a sudden they're not orthogonal anymore. And so you end up with a set of non-orthogonal states, and you write them down like this. In this case, they all came from the same diagonalization, but they're not orthogonal, and so you have to do the Gram-Schmidt again. Okay, so if you do that, it works pretty well, not quite as well as this, but still satisfactorily, quite nicely. So this is the second method that works. So yet again, Gram-Schmidt, that works well. Okay, one way of thinking about what's going on is that when you have a larger system, you know, there's quantum fluctuations. If you consider a part of the system, you think of quantum fluctuations between, you know, between the two parts of the system. You know, the particle, you got one particle, it's either there or it's not. It's fluctuating back and forth. When we're dealing with this one particle problem in this way, we have to pay attention to the fact that essentially there's quantum fluctuations. You can think of that as applying different boundary conditions. You have to have the different boundary conditions that allow the different possibilities that are part of what goes on in the system. So in this part, we were explicitly putting in the different boundary conditions, thinking that maybe that's related to some sort of quantum fluctuation. Here, you just take a bigger system, which automatically has some of the quantum fluctuations, and by picking out the piece and projecting out, you automatically build in a key part of that, what's missing in this, and then you find out it works quite well. Okay. So the right way to really understand this is to play around with it. And so I'm going to tell you in detail how you can implement. So these two ideas, particularly this last one and part of this, sort of leads up to one of the key ideas of DMRG, the way it iterates. So I'm going to sort of explain now how you can implement some of these ideas to make sort of a DMRG procedure for one particle. Implementing two, where the block knows where it works. Okay, so focus on this particular method where we have the exact wave function that we want, and then we would know which piece to keep for the block so that it all worked. But how can you do that when you don't know the final answer? That's what you're trying to get. Okay, so what I'm going to tell you about now is how you put it all together so that you can keep the piece that you want and iterate to the correct final answer at the same time. So it's sort of like chicken and the egg problem, where if you have the chicken, I can get the egg, but how can I get the chicken without the egg? And which came first, the chicken or the egg? And the answer to that problem is that, you know, the state is, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Well, first you start out with a really lousy chicken and a really lousy egg. They gradually evolve to a good chicken and a good egg. And that's evolution, and that's an iterative procedure in computational physics. So what we want here is an iterative procedure where we build up simultaneously the whole wave function and also blocks. Okay. So the first thing that has to go is that you can't just add blocks together. Because the states that you're keeping are all different. So here's a block, and maybe it's the first block, and it looks like that. The second block is different, and if you added two of them together like that, you get something that you don't want. You get a kink. Okay, the way we can take care of this is to go back to the idea of adding sites. Okay, one site doesn't have any truncations in it at all, so it's always perfectly accurate. So if you have a good block, you can always add a site onto it. And so we're going to go to a picture where we have a block that looks like this, the left part of the system, and then we add a single site to it. So plus the site is equal to a slightly bigger block. Okay, with one site longer, okay, and then this one is still a part of that one, but we haven't introduced any assumptions that the two parts are somehow, two blocks are the same. Okay, so the question then is, how do you know what piece to keep? And in order to be able to deal with the fact that the wave function, you know, we're supposed to have a representation of the wave function for the whole system. We want a psi for the big system. So it's natural to use a block to represent the right-hand side of the system. Okay, so here's the left-hand block, and then we're thinking of adding a site to it. Okay, and now in order to figure out what piece to add, we need some representation of the bigger system. Okay, let's make it look the same. And we'll have a right-hand block. So the idea is that you're taking a left-hand block and adding a site. And this, so this is B, and this is going to be a B prime. And so we're trying to do a small RG step that only adds one site and does it in the right way. We have an extra block over here that helps us do that. This is called the environment block. And the idea is that when you've converged, that this environment block is an excellent representation of the right-hand part of the wave function. This is a good representation of the left-hand part of the wave function. And as you grow it, it is using the correct overall wave function in order to build up all the pieces. Okay? But it's an iterative procedure. So what you imagine is that you start out with a B that's kind of a crappy block and an environment block that's kind of lousy. And you need to have an iterative procedure that builds it up and converges, so it has to always somehow make the representation better. Okay, so the iteration here starts with a block on the left that's just a single site, and a big block on the right that would ideally represent all but the last three cells of the system. We get a B prime here. Our B prime looks like that. And over here, we have another environment block. This environment block is different from that one, but this one was what helped create this one over here. So let's just focus on the left-hand side. We grow it by one site using an environment block that we stored up. And then we keep going. The right-hand blocks keep getting smaller until we get all the way to the other side. And there's just a couple of sites on the other side. Or you didn't stop one more before that. And then you turn around and you reverse the role of the block that you're looking at, the system block and the environment block. So now you start growing the right-hand side. So you start with, here is a big environment block. And we grow this to get a new right-hand block here, a system block. And then we continue down, growing the right-hand side. As we grew these blocks, we stored all of them. And so as we're growing these, we just keep calling these other blocks from memory. And we go to the right-hand side. Okay. And eventually you get all the way back to the beginning, and then you repeat. So there's a dividing line between the system that's going that way, then that way, then that way. And when you're going this way, the left block is growing, and you hope that the left blocks that you're growing and you're saving are getting more and more accurate. The right-hand blocks are just being called up from memory. And when you get to the other side, you reverse the roles, and the right blocks get better and better. Now, if you want to get some idea that this would converge, if you look at the energy for this particle in a box system that you're trying to, you know, in this example you're trying to solve, you can see pretty quickly that the energy is never going to increase. You know, you have a wave function and it has a certain energy, and you're taking out the piece of it that allows you to have that wave function, but then you give it a little bit of extra degrees of freedom, and it decreases in energy, and then you move on to the next step. And so the energy is guaranteed never to go up, so it at least has a chance of converging. How fast it converges is a separate issue. Okay, so this procedure, the algorithm here is the finite system method for DMRG minus the many particle aspect. Okay, so by understanding this, you get a big chunk of DMRG, and then you just have to worry about the many particle part. And so this is key, and let's see. And so what I think I'll do is, in the notes, you'll see the details for implementing this for a particle in a box. And then I've also made available a program that does this procedure to solve a particle in a box. Let's see, how do I turn the projector on? Okay, so I wrote a very simple program to do this D GMRG for one particle. And it's, depending on how big your page is, it's about a page long. Okay, and what I want you to do is to basically make this program your own. What, by that I mean, you may like to write in Python. You may like to write in MATLAB. Or you may like C++. So here's this program. And let me show you the rest of it. Okay, that's the rest of it, one page down. And it's written in C++, and it uses my matrix library. And that matrix library is available on the web if you want it. So one thing you can do is, if you want to, you can download, this program is near where the notes are on the web. And you can download this, and you can, if you want to, you can download the matrix library that will allow you to just compile this and run it. Downloading a library and stuff is some work, and so you might not want to do it that way, but if you want to, you can do it that way. But I think it's also fairly readable, the whole idea of some of the notation of the matrix library is just to make it as readable as possible. And so you have vectors, and you have matrices. Here we have a 3x3 matrix. Okay. So with the notes, we have the details of the matrices involved. Now there is a difference. The notes have the algorithm that I've talked about here with two sites in the center. Two sites in the center will make the algorithm converge faster, but it will still work with just one site in the center. And so this program, to make it as simple as possible, just has one site in the center. So the 3x3 matrix it has, and it's just keeping one state. So the 3x3 matrix, the first index corresponds to the wave function in the left block. The middle index corresponds to a site in the center. And the third index corresponds to the right-hand block. And you can see, here's the off-diagonal parts. This is like the T. And up here, the diagonal parts start out as a 2. That's the diagonal piece of the matrix. And so here's where you take the 3x3 matrix and you assign the elements in just the pieces that you need. And then the matrix library has built into it eigenvalues, which obviously you don't want to write yourself. So whatever way you do it, you need to have an eigenvalue routine. You don't need too much more than that. I think that's the only little pieces there. There's some fairly obvious notation about working with submatrices. So this is the upper 2x2 part of the 3x3 matrix. Submatrix 1, 2, 1, 2. Subvector appears up here. This is the subvector from a 3-long vector to 1 to 2. Okay, so what I'm hoping you can do is play with this, and then once you get it working, the idea is to play with it and make it better. And so the version I had just had one site in the center. It'll be better if you put two sites in the center. It would be even better if you put even more sites in the center. It gives it more freedom to converge faster. So you can do that. If this were an interacting problem, we couldn't put too many sites in the center, because that's like doing a big exact diagonalization with more and more sites. And so you run into trouble. But it's not much of an extra load here. You can keep more states in the left side and the right side. And because this does take a while to converge, between 20 and 100 sweeps back and forth for 100, a system of size 100. So you can try to make it better, keep more states, make it go faster. If you want to, you can see who can write the shortest program. that does this, or find ways to improve this program. For instance, I have a completely separate loops for the left to right pass, and then this is the right to left pass, and you could combine those into one loop. And so that would be a way of, if you do that in a nice way, it could make it better. Okay, so anyway, I hope you have time to play around with this and hopefully have some fun with it, and this is how you really get to learn this. Okay. Questions? Yeah.
Is there any difference if I want to calculate the first excited state?
So if you did this and you kept two states per block, okay, and then when you diagonalize, there's a step where you diagonalize the system. Up here, eigenvalues, that diagonalize the system, but I only make use of the first block. So I'm only looking at the ground state. If you want to get two states, then you would make use of two states. And you have to figure out how to do that, but that would be a very nice thing to do. Yeah.
I got a little confused. I never studied this before. So in classical, statistical mechanics, RT means that you normalize the partition function. Okay. Now here, presumably the equivalent is normalized amplitudes, scattering amplitudes, let's say, for one particle in the box, let's say. Okay. So now you go and you generalize a Hamiltonian, and you look at low energy states. But it's clear that the scattering amplitudes have a normalization problem too. It's not because this is the problem of the partition function doesn't sum up to one, but the scattering amplitude has to have a normalization.
Okay, so
the question is it all of these ways of fixing this normalization problem?
That's a very good question, and people have the name. You know, DMRG is partly historical because it came from something that was more clearly a renormalization procedure. Wilson's method, included the usual renormalization group analysis, and this was one part, this was a numerical part, that was a way of implementing that. And so partly it was historical, partly because, it sounded reasonably good. But it's gotten the solution to these problems of the original RG, drove it farther away from RG. It's not as close. And so it's best not to think of it so much in that language. And in the next lecture, we're going to see how really this is tied very closely with ideas from quantum information. And so now we can think of it as a low entanglement approximation method. And then it doesn't look like an RG method. And I could have started with that point of view. I think this gives you a lot more intuition. But so don't get stuck on too much of other RG methods. Okay. More questions? Okay. We're done for the afternoon.